world is broken with you. Do you feel the shadows deepen with you? Do you know that all the dark won't stop the light from getting through with you? Do you wish that you could see it all made new with you? Is all creation groaning? It is. Is a new creation coming? It is. Is the glory of the Lord to be the light within our midst? It is. Is it good that we remind ourselves of this? It is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. Is he worthy? Is he worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is he worthy of this? Truly love us, He does. Does the Spirit move among us? He does. And does Jesus our Messiah hold forever those He loves? He does. Does our God intend to dwell again with us? He does. Is anyone worthy? Is anyone whole? Is anyone able to break the seal and open the scroll? The Lion of Judah, who conquered the grave, is David's root and the Lamb who died to ransom the slave. From every people and tribe, every nation and tongue, He has made us a kingdom and priest to God to reign with the Son. Is He worthy? Is He worthy of all blessing and honor and glory? Is He worthy? Is He worthy? Is He worthy of this? Word. Christ alone, my hope is found. He is my light, my strength, my song. This cornerstone, this solid ground, firm through the fiercest drought and storm. What heights of love, what depths of peace, when fears are stilled, when striving cease. My comforter, my all in all, here in the love of Christ I stand. In Christ alone, who took on flesh, fullness of God in helpless babe. This gift of love and righteousness, scorned by the ones he came to save. Till on that cross, as Jesus died, the wrath of God was satisfied. For every sin on him was laid, here in the death of Christ I lay. There in the ground his body laid, light of the world by darkness slain. Then bursting forth in glorious day, up from the grave he rose again. And as he stands in victory, since curse has lost its grip on me, for I am his and he is mine, bought with the precious blood of. No guilt in life, no fear in death. This is the power of Christ in me. From life's first cry to final breath, Jesus commands my destiny. No power of hell, no scheme of man can ever pluck me from his hand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ I stand. Till he returns or calls me home, here in the power of Christ.
My father wrote about this in his book, chapter 1, page 1, paragraph 1. What is the answer to 99 out of 100 questions? Money.
It's not over yet.
It is for me, sister. Look, I ain't in this for your revolution, man. I'm not in it for you, princess. I expect to be well paid. I'm in it for the money.
Why didn't you just come after me?
No, this is about me. This is about my money. This is about money due me, which I will collect. $3.7 million.
And now, folks, it's time for who do you trust? Hubba, hubba, hubba. Money, money, money. Who do you trust?
Well, how much are you going to invest?
$5,000. $10,000. $5,000.
You needn't worry about your reward. Money is all that you love, and that's what you'll receive.
For some folks, money's a foreign film without subtitles.
And you're completely obsessed with treasure.
Me? I'm giving away free money.
Friend, some of your folding money has come unstowed.
It's my nest egg, Jack. At my age, you've got to think ahead.
Absolutely not. I'm a businessman. I love money, I love power, I love capitalism. I do not now and never will love children.
My name is Inigo Montoya. You killed my father. Prepare to die.
Now!
Offer me money.
Yes.
Power to promise me that.
All that I have and more. Please.
Look, man, all these jokers have got a lot of money and it belongs to me. I want to know who they are and what they're doing with it.
I'm sorry about that, man. I really am. Money does bad things to people. There ain't no excuse for it.
Money.
I'm going to say money.
I remember hearing a story a while back about an elderly man, a rich man, who had his wife promise him that she would bury him with all his money when he died. He had worked hard his whole life and decided that every penny that he had made belonged to him, and he wanted to take it with him when he died. So sure enough, his death date came around, and as he lay in his casket at the funeral, as the grieving people paid respects to him, the ushers were about to close the casket up when his grieving widow in black raised her hand and said, "Wait, I've got one more thing." And she had a shoebox with her, and she walked over to the casket, placed the shoebox in it, and walked back to her seat next to her best friend. Her friend leaned over to her and said, "You didn't really give that old geezer all the money, did you?" The widow said, "You know, I sure did. I'm a Christian. I can't lie. I have to honor my word. He put it in his will. He made me promise that I would bury him with all his money." And her friend said, "Are you sure you put every dollar in that shoebox? You put everything in there?" And she said, "Yeah, I sure did. I put all his money into my checking account, and I wrote him a check. And I put that check in that shoebox." Money, according to some people, is what makes the world go round. Money is what makes the monkey dance. Money is one of those things in life that some people have way too much of it. Some people don't have enough. And some people have enough just to get by to the next paycheck. Money is something that we're so enthralled with. It's something that drives us mad and drives us to make different decisions. It influences the way we live and the social classes and social structures that we involve ourselves with. Money is a big issue. Wealth is a big issue. And this morning we have to ask ourselves, how should a wise person view money? How should a wise person view money? This morning, we're going to look at Scripture, and we're going to look at different ways that we should view money according to the book of Proverbs. Now, we started this series here at the beginning of the summer called Life Hacks, and we're going through different Proverbs in the Old Testament. And the book of Proverbs is a very weird, interesting book because it's not a book that is full of laws or rules for us to follow, but it basically just gives us wisdom. Wisdom from above, wisdom from God, like a father to a son, wisdom, good things that we should live by, things we're not required to live by, but things that are just these general sayings, these general poems and different sayings that we put on our refrigerators or we put on bumper stickers, things that we remind ourselves of. And so today I'm going to be taking several verses from Proverbs that are concerning money. Now, the Bible does talk a lot about money. If you go to the New Testament, 1 in 7 verses are dealing with money. 1 in 7 verses talking about money. Money was so interesting that Jesus, in half of the parables he told, dealt with money in the teachings that he had. And so money is a pretty big deal because so many of us make idols of money. So many of us are, as I said, driven insane by money. And so it becomes a very important topic to talk about. And so that's why we're going to share some time with money this morning as we dig into the book of Proverbs. Real quick, I want to read a quote to you from one of my favorite pastors, Timothy Keller. Tim Keller says, "There can be no significant spiritual growth in your life unless you put your money and what you think about your money into God's hands." And so money becomes more of a spiritual issue for us. It becomes more of a crossroads for us when it comes to putting our trust in it, when it comes to seeing money as the ultimate end game for us in our lives and our relationship with God. It becomes an important topic to dwell on and spend some time on. And so that's why we're going to talk about it here this morning. And so this morning, we're going to read a lot of Proverbs to kind of answer this question: how should wise people deal with money? How should a wise person view money? And the first thing that we see in the book of Proverbs is that money is a gift. Proverbs chapter 10, verse 22 says, "The blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow with it." Money is a gift. Money is a gift from God. It is a blessing from God. God is the one who gives us the finances that we have in our lives. Now, I know you may be sitting there thinking, oh, wait, I worked hard for my money. My money is mine. I have money in my bank account right now because of my hard work and me putting time in each week to my job, me doing a particular skill or doing a particular side gig or whatever. But a lot of us, we tend to put stock in what we can accomplish and what we can do, when a lot of times we forget that money is a blessing from God. The riches are a blessing from God. God is the one who has empowered us to work. God has given us life. God has given us these bodies to go to work and to do labor with. Some of us use our bodies and use the manual labor and the different physical abilities that our bodies can perform to earn money and to do work and to have a healthy income. Some of us are sitting behind a desk all day, sitting behind a computer. Some of us are preaching to people. Some of us are doing all kinds of different things to make money. Some of us use our vehicles. Some of us use the skills that we've been trained to do, whether we went to college or not. But we all are working different various jobs, and we have those jobs because of God, because of his providence, because he has blessed us with life and the skills and the means to do so, the means to make money in the first place. And so I think a lot of people, when they look at money, they view it more as an idol. They view it as something that they worship because it's something that they accomplished on their own, when in reality, we have to be grounded and we have to remember that first and foremost, money is a gift. Money is a gift from God. The blessing of the Lord makes rich, and he adds no sorrow with it. Now, there is a lot of confusion in the Christian world about what it means to be blessed by God and what it means to be rich in God. There is this false gospel, the prosperity gospel that's out there, and we have to be reminded, we have to be grounded to be reminded that just because we become Christians, just because we give our life to the Lord, just because we worship God and read our Bibles and give offering at church, that doesn't mean that God is going to bless us. It doesn't mean that God is going to provide health and wealth to us. There is no promise in the Bible that God is going to do that. The book of Proverbs is not even a book of promises. They're just a book of generalities. There are no distinct promises to us in Proverbs. It's just good wisdom. It's good stuff to follow. And it's good to be reminded that money is a gift from God. First and foremost, money is a gift. The second thing that we learn from the book of Proverbs this morning is that money has limitations. Money has limitations. Listen to Proverbs 16:6. "How much better to get wisdom than gold? To get understanding is to be chosen rather than silver." Let me read that one more time. "How much better to get wisdom than gold? To get understanding is to be better or is to be chosen rather than silver. Money has limitations. So many times we put our faith and we put our trust in the wrong things. Sometimes it's a person, sometimes it's the security of our jobs or the security of our homes or a relationship, you name it. But we try to put faith and we try to put stock and we try to put our trust in things that are superficial, things that are going to eventually end, things that are not as stable as we think they are. And money just so happens to be one of those things. Money has limitations. We idolize money sometimes, and we try to build our lives around our money. We think, oh, if I just had enough money, if I just had enough of it, then I could travel, or I could do what I wanted to. I wouldn't have to work anymore. I could send my kids to college. I can pay off all my debt if I just had more, if I just had more money. And it's crazy how many times you see these stories of rich people, people that do have a lot of money, these multi-billionaires, and how they're not even happy with all the money that they have. And you see how some of these situations where people win the lotto end up to be pretty bad. The story is not a happy ending kind of story in the end, because money has its limitations. We can't put our full faith and our full trust in money because it is superficial. It's here today, gone tomorrow. It doesn't last forever. And a lot of times we think money can solve all of our problems, and in reality, it really can't. You hear about people that are well off, but then they get some kind of terminal diagnosis where they're not able to live out a long, healthy life. And so all that money that they've made, all that money that they have, is for nothing, because money can't buy the amount of medical care that they would need to survive whatever diagnosis that is. You hear of all these different stories of people that are at the end of their lives unhappy with the way they spent their money or the way they spent their life because of their view of money. Money has limitations. Money is not the end all. Money can't help us in every situation. I think about all those people on the Titanic. A lot of those people were rich. One of the richest men in the world, John Jacob Astor, was on the Titanic. Was definitely the wealthiest man on the ship. And he and his wife perished that night on that ship when the ship hit the iceberg. He died, and his money could not save him, could not save his life. That money was no good to him at that point in his life. It was not the thing that he needed. And so money, we are reminded in the book of Proverbs, has limitations. The third thing that we see in the book of Proverbs regarding money is that money must be handled well. Money must be handled well. We're going to look at two verses for this point. The first comes from Proverbs 28:8. It says, "Whoever multiplies his wealth by interest and profit gathers it for him who is generous to the poor." And then Proverbs 13:11 says, "Wealth gained hastily will dwindle, but whoever gathers little by little will increase it." And so first we've learned that money is a gift, that money has limitations, and now we've learned that money must be handled well. One of the best ways we can honor God, one of the best things that we can do with the money and the finances that He has blessed us with, is to be good stewards of it, to handle it well. Yes, it is wise to invest in things that we know that will grow our money, that we don't take risks that are too extreme with that money, so that way we can grow our finances and that we can grow and build more wealth and build more income so that we can bless others with it. And so we learn that money must be handled well. There are some of us, when we get money, it burns a hole in our pocket and we want to spend it right away. I remember as a kid, I used to get birthday cards from my grandparents full of money, and I would just like be like a kid at the candy store. Literally, I would go to the toy store, I would go to the toy aisle and at the store, and I would just start looking at all the things I could buy right away. I never had the sense about me when I was a kid to save money. And now I look back on that and I'm like, man, I wish I had all that money that I spent on toys back then, even though those toys brought me satisfaction and fun back then. Or I think about when I was a teenager and I started working my own jobs, and I blew a lot of that money on like fast food, and I blew a lot of it just on going out to hang out with friends and stuff. And I just think to myself, man, had I just saved some of that, that would have been nice. I wouldn't have blown all of it. But we are called, we are given this wisdom from God to handle our money well. Money must be handled well. I remember when I was a bank teller at Wells Fargo when I was in college, I remember having this lady come in and she was huffing and puffing. She was mad at me. I had no reason why, but she walked in to the counter. I was the next teller available. She came up to me and she said, "Listen, my bank account is in the negative right now. Can you tell me why my bank account is in the negative? I don't think it should be in the negative." And so I said, "Okay, sure. You know, let's open your bank account here, and I'll be glad to read off some of the charges and see what's going on." And so she gave me her, you know, debit card and her information. We pulled up her bank account, and I said, "Well, you are in the negative because it looks like you ate out 6 times this week. It looks like you went to Blockbuster. Do you guys remember Blockbuster? I know I look young, but I'm old enough to remember what Blockbuster was. And I still have my Blockbuster card tucked away somewhere. Blockbuster was awesome. Now we can just do it all online, whatever. But yeah, I was like, okay, you went to Blockbuster, you know, like 3 times this week. You've eaten out all these times. Like I started listing all the charges that she had on her account, and her mouth just opened up wide. And I think it was in that moment that it hit her, like, oh my gosh, I've been irresponsible with my money. I haven't been spending my money well. And so we have to remember that money must be handled well. It's a gift from God. God has blessed us with it. And so if we are to live under the umbrella of God's wisdom, God's influence in our lives, we have to be good stewards. We have to take care of what God has blessed us with. And so we do that by investing in things that we know will grow our money, things that will bless others, things that will be profitable for us, that we don't just blow money on risks and random things. Some people like to gamble and spend all kinds of money just chasing after different things that aren't going to pan out for them at the end. And so we have to remember that money must be handled well. So money is a gift. Money has limitations. And money must be handled well. And the fourth thing that we learn from the book of Proverbs about money this morning is that money must be shared generously. Money must be shared generously. Proverbs 22:9 says, "Whoever has a bountiful eye will be blessed, for he shares his bread with the poor." One of the most important things we can do with the finances that we've been blessed with is to turn that money around, turn those finances around, and bless others. We are taught so many times in Scripture and by Jesus himself to love others as ourselves, to love others, to lay our own lives down for our brothers and sisters, to give of ourselves, just as Christ gave of himself whenever he rescued and redeemed us. And so just in that same way, that same kind of love that Christ demonstrated, we are to demonstrate that same kind of love as we become more like him, as we become bearers of his witness, bearers of the good news, the gospel in this world. We are to bless others. And one of the ways we can do that is through the giving of our finances to others. It is good to donate to charities that are doing good in this world. It is good to donate to great causes. It's good to give to people and to individuals who need help. I know this last year and a half or so with the pandemic has been really trying. But at the same time, even though there were hardships going on, so many people still stepped up and they gave when they had money to give. They supported people that were out of work or supported people that needed money to pay bills or to make rent or to buy groceries. It is a good thing to use the money that we're blessed with to give. And even though it's not a promise in the book of Proverbs, even though it's not guaranteed that if we give our money away that we're going to just get richer or get more, this verse does kind of give us this indication that whoever does this, whoever has a bountiful eye, will be blessed. It may not be financially, but maybe God will do something radical in another way. But generosity is something that should mark every Christian. We should all be generous in the way we give, in the way we lay our finances down, because it's a form of surrendering to God. It's a form of turning away from our own passions, our own desires, our own idolatry, and saying, you know, God, I'm not so attached to this money where I can't help other people. I'm not so attached to this money where it's my one source of security in life. So I want to encourage you this morning, look at the book of Proverbs, look at the way that it talks about money, and I want you to begin to think about these areas in your life. Are you viewing money as a gift from God? Are you viewing it as an idol? Do you recognize the limitations that money has? Have you tried to make too much out of money? Has that become your source of stability? Have you handled money well? How much debt are you in this morning? How have you spent the money that you have received or you have worked hard for? Have you put it away in savings to where you can build up money to have in retirement or to pass to your children? What are you doing to be generous with your money? How are you blessing others? How are you blessing your church and the work of God's kingdom with your finances? How are you honoring God with the finances that you have? This morning, I want to challenge you to think differently about money. I hope that this conversation this morning will make some fireworks go off in your head. It will help you find a new way to view money. How should a wise person view money? A wise person views money as a gift, recognizes its limitations, handles it well, and shares it generously. A wise person views money as a gift, recognizes its limitations, handles it well, and shares it generously. Let's pray. Lord, this morning, we love you. We thank you. We thank you for giving us wisdom to look at in the book of Proverbs regarding money and wealth and finances. God, I pray that you will guide us as we strive to be more like you, as we strive to honor you with the way we treat money here in this world. Lord, we know that money is superficial. We know it's fading. It's not something that's going to last forever. Lord, we know that we can make good decisions with money, or we can make horrible decisions. So this morning, I pray that you'll give us your wisdom. You'll continue to allow that wisdom to penetrate our hearts so that we are thinking wisely about our money. We're using our money wisely. We're blessing others with the finances, the money that we have been given from you, Lord. That we recognize that it's a gift. That we recognize that it has limitations. And that we know that we should handle it well. Lord, let us be generous. Let us be wise, and let us honor you most of all in everything we do regarding our finances. We love you and we thank you. In Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you for joining us today online at Grace Covenant Church. Before you leave, please take a moment to consider giving a donation to our ministry. When we give, we are making an offering to God as a way of giving back to Him with what He has blessed us with. We offer several convenient ways to give. You can give online by going to our website at www.gracecovssf.com/give. You can also text any dollar amount to 84321 to give by text. Let's stay connected. Follow us on social media and sign up for our email newsletter by going to the homepage of our website. Thanks for watching. We will see you again soon.